At 10:30, it's time for Virtuoso, which this week features the harpsichordist George Malcolm. The programme is introduced by Edward Greenfield.
If you've ever thought of the harpsichord as a fuddy-duddy instrument, just listen to this. The flight of the bumblebee, with Rimsky-Korsakov's bee buzzing away as never before. That's a virtuoso piece which has been transcribed for many instruments. There was a famous version for trumpet, I remember, played by Harry James. But my favourite's that one by George Malcolm, an arrangement he made himself for the harpsichord. You'd think, of course, that anyone who could play the harpsichord like that would have been single-minded all his life, dedicated to that one instrument. But not so with George Malcolm. He's been quoted as actually preferring to play the piano. I was interested to read in Edward Heath's book on music a reference to his exact contemporary, George Malcolm, at Oxford. Heath was the organ scholar at Balliol, while Malcolm was the composition scholar. After complimenting him on his technique, even in his teens, and his fabulous memory for music, Heath comments, "To him everything seemed to come easily, and I envied him his facility." I'm not sure how George Malcolm would take that compliment. I have a feeling he'd prefer to be congratulated on his more substantial qualities, not just his natural facility. And for that matter, he wouldn't want me to concentrate on party pieces like The Flight of the Bumblebee. So, as a first sample of how expressively he could make the harpsichord sing, no easy thing with an instrument whose sound has been likened to scratching a birdcage with a toasting fork, is one of the most haunting of the sonatas of Domenico Scarlatti, the one usually labelled Pastorale. Scarlatti's sonata in D minor, the famous Pastorale. Even before he became an undergraduate, George Malcolm was the official organist of a church in Oxford. And when, after war service in the RAF, he first achieved fame, it was as a choirmaster and organist, rather than as a harpsichordist. He was master of music at Westminster Cathedral. And there he was among the first in this country deliberately to encourage the choristers to use throaty, boyish, continental tone in polyphonic music by Palestrina and others. Benjamin Britten was so impressed by trebles who sang out with good, open vowels instead of cooing in the old Anglican style that he wrote his delightful Missa Brevis for Malcolm and the choir. But after 6 years, George Malcolm boldly left that choirmaster's job and branched out as a soloist, for by that time his virtuosity as a harpsichordist was setting new standards. More than his predecessors, he exploited the range of tone colours possible, many of them very subtle. He regularly used the different stops, not to mention the different manuals or keyboards, just as he would on an organ. One of the composers whose keyboard music he did more than anyone in this country to get appreciated was the 18th century French composer, contemporary of Bach and Handel, Jean-Philippe Rameau. Often it came to seem extraordinarily modern. From the suite in E minor, here's The Summoning of the Birds. When you remember that this music was written 250 years ago, the clashing sounds are extraordinary. Then there's Tambourin, an earthy folk dance with a drone bass. The Summoning of the Birds and Tambourin by Rameau. Naturally, as a harpsichordist, George Malcolm has come to be a great specialist in the music of Bach. His performances of the Goldberg Variations quickly became celebrated, spread over a whole concert. For, unlike his immediate predecessors, he observed all the repeats. He dared to do that, not just in concert, but on record, when he made a point of varying the registration, altering the tone colours when the same music came round again. Here's an example of that from the fifth of Bach's so-called French suites, the Gavotte, and you'll notice the different colourings each time. The Gavotte from Bach's Fifth French Suite. In the reference books, George Malcolm's listed as a composer as well as a performer. Here, in one of his lighter works, is his comment on the great Johann Sebastian Bach as seafarer, Bach before the mast. Thank you. Bach Before the Mast, George Malcolm's own variations on the sailor's hornpipe. He also wrote another set of variations, this time on a theme of Mozart, which exploited not only his own virtuosity, but that of three other harpsichordists. For some years they had an annual concert at the Royal Festival Hall, provoked by George Malcolm, with multiple concertos for two, three, and four harpsichords. And also this set of variations. Here's the end of that charming showpiece. Delightful payoff, that. Variations on a theme of Mozart by George Malcolm. Besides the composer, the other harpsichordists were Valda Aveling, Geoffrey Parsons and Simon Preston. But to cool off after that, let's hear George Malcolm playing the lovely slow movement of the F minor harpsichord concerto of Bach, a piece originally written for a cantata with an oboe taking the flowing melody. But again, very simply, George Malcolm really makes the harpsichord sing. slow movement from Bach's F minor harpsichord concerto, with George Malcolm, accompanied by Yehudi Menuhin and the Menuhin Festival Orchestra. Though he remains first and foremost a virtuoso of the harpsichord, one who has set the pattern for a whole talented generation of younger rivals, George Malcolm still appears occasionally as an organist. In fact, only last year they issued on record his complete set of the Handel Organ Concertos. Here's one of the most famous movements, the Allegro from the concerto, which, for reasons very plain to hear, has long been called the Cuckoo and the Nightingale. Exhilarating playing there by George Malcolm on the organ of St. Mary's Rotherhithe, accompanied by Neville Mariner and the Academy of St. Martin in the Fields, with, incidentally, Christopher Hogwood playing the harpsichord continuo. The second movement from Handel's concerto in F, The Cuckoo and the Nightingale. The crispness and point of that playing reflects the sharpness of George Malcolm's character as a man. I always like the way he tends at a recital to address the audience, filling in gaps in the programme notes. He He may look ascetic and even mournful, but appearances are deceptive, and if, even after his own music, you want confirmation of his wit, let me finally play a piece from what they nowadays tend to call the middle of the road. Bach Goes to Town by Alec Templeton, the sort of jazzing that no one can object to. Let me play that not just as a final tribute to George Malcolm, but also as a promise for next week. I'll leave you on Bach Goes to Town, and I'll be coming back next week with that same music, played by its first famous interpreter, a clarinetist and virtuoso who spans many fields of music, Benny Goodman. Till then, goodbye.
Bach Goes to Town, played by George Malcolm. Virtuoso is presented by Edward Greenfield. The producer was Andrew Musset.